next on Unsolved Mysteries. A driver walks away from a car crash and disappears. She may be suffering from amnesia. In Nevada, one haunted house, two frightened families, and a ghost named Samuel. 6 months after moving to a new town, a young woman is found murdered in the front seat of her car. And a violent mob boss uses a suburban neighborhood as a front for an international drug running scheme. Five fascinating mysteries, some just waiting to be solved. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries. Danbury, Connecticut. Reggie DePalma was the supervisor of Danbury's ambulance service and a 12-year fire department veteran. In his spare time, he organized an Explorer Scout troop. His girlfriend Connie was his co-leader, and the group quickly became a popular after-school activity.
When I first joined the troop, my impression of Reggie and Connie were that they were very nice people, so it was just never even a question that you would not trust them with anything. I mean, you just tell them confidential things, and you would really feel like you would trust them all the time and go to them if you needed help.
To the Explorer Scouts, especially the girls, Reggie DePalma was a trusted father figure. What the girls did not know was that DePalma's motive in gaining their trust was to ultimately betray them.
Should we put him here?
Yes, put the blankets down.
Under DePalma's leadership, the Explorer troop grew to include 15 girls and 10 boys. They met at the fire station where they learned life-saving and rescue techniques.
You're gonna be administering five pumps in the chest. Ready to start? Ready?
One. It's kind of hard to describe Reggie. Reggie was a lot of fun. Reggie and his girlfriend, Connie, they were easygoing people. They were easy to talk to. If you had a problem, they really wanted you to open up to them and get close to them. And, you know, they were good at getting people's trust.
One Halloween, the Explorers organized a haunted house to raise money for an upcoming camping trip.
So you're 13 and you still don't have a boyfriend?
Yeah.
Have you ever gone all the way with a boy before?
No.
Well, I'd like to teach you about that. Because I'm your friend. Are you my friend?
Yeah.
Good.
I thought that he was concerned with me and, you know, how I'd, you know, handle it, because we were at that age. And, you know, I took it as like a fatherly concern and, you know, something that, you know, he wanted to not be a part of, but help with.
Hey, are you okay?
Yeah, just something Reggie said.
Connie came up to me and said, you know, we have to go get some things. You know, why don't you come with me? And we, you know, promptly went back to the house where Reggie was waiting.
Can't have you upset. Okay, well, here's the towel.
We went back to the apartment and, you know, she said, why don't you go shower and, you know, get some of this makeup off. So I did. Didn't think anything of it. When I came out, it all happened.
Hey.
Hey.
Come on in, honey.
Yeah, we're just watching some TV. It's okay.
That night, DePalma forced Terry to have sex with him while Connie watched. Terry, was not his first victim, and she wouldn't be his last.
I was 13 years old, and I did not go immediately to my parents or the authorities, because at that age, I don't think that you have any understanding even what's going on. You just feel a terrible amount of humiliation, of guilt. What did I do wrong to cause this to happen?
I don't know what to do.
Over the next year, De Palma continued to sexually abuse girls in the Explorer group. But by then, they had begun to confide in each other.
One of the girls had gotten upset about something and started talking, and it just started snowballing, because as soon as she said something, then the next person, and everybody started coming forth, and then we all realized that we weren't alone, that we were all in this group together, and that together we could try to stop this.
We have to tell somebody. I'll tell my mom. Okay.
One of the girl's mothers came to the police station to report what her daughter had told her. So Detective Benjamin and I were assigned to investigate this, and I spoke with all the girls involved, and he spoke with all the boys. These girls were so devastated over what had happened to them that I had nightmares. The details of what they were telling me made me feel such rage towards this man. I had to get him arrested as soon as possible.
You have the right to remain silent. Do you understand? If you waive that right, anything you say or do will be used against you in a court of law. Do you understand?
Yeah.
The same day police arrested Reggie, they questioned his girlfriend, Connie.
She felt so insecure about their relationship that she even went this far to do these things with these girls for Reggie.
Ladies and gentlemen, I just have one more.
Connie pled guilty to risking injury to a minor and was sentenced to 5 years in prison. De Palma went to trial on 9 counts, including 2 counts of statutory rape and 5 counts of risking injury to a minor.
I thought that they would think less of me, and Reggie had told me not to tell anybody.
Reggie
De Palma, the first day during the trial, it was obvious that he did not believe the girls had the courage to testify against him. He felt he still had sufficient sway over them that they would crumble on the witness stand. After the first witness was able to testify against him, certainly then his confidence had to waver. And of course, after the third girl had testified, he must have decided that he would be better in parts unknown.
After the 5th day of the trial, De Palma, who was out on bail, went to visit his mother in the hospital. Although his car was found in the parking lot, he never showed up in his mother's room. Reggie De Palma had vanished, and a fugitive warrant was issued for his arrest. The trial continued without De Palma, and he was convicted on 7 counts and sentenced to 21 years in prison.
When I think about the fact that he's still out there somewhere, is very upsetting. The first, of course, to all of us, the injustice that we feel because he is not paying for the crimes that were committed. And then again, the fear for other people out there that he could be harming individuals all over again and put them all through this living hell.
Update. After nearly 17 years on the run, Reggie De Palma was finally captured by authorities in Florida. A tip led the FBI to De Palma, who had been living in Jacksonville under the alias Lawrence Mateo. De Palma now had a wife and 3 children. Reggie De Palma was returned to Connecticut and ordered to serve his 21-year sentence for child molestation. He served his time and has been released. Next, perhaps you've seen this young woman. She disappeared after crashing into another car. Circle, Montana. On a dark country road, a driver narrowly avoids a head-on collision with a woman driving on the wrong side of the road. Another driver, Carol Heights, witnesses the near miss. And then the car heads straight towards Carol. Carol emerges from the wreckage dazed, but not seriously injured. And then a woman appears out of the darkness. It's the driver who hit Carol.
She just stared. Never said anything, nothing, just stared at me. I will never forget her.
The driver of the first car, who has returned to help, also sees the silent woman.
As I looked out across the accident, I noticed someone on the other side of the fence standing there like a spectator, not like that it had happened to her.
The silent woman walks away from the accident scene and vanishes into the night. Police trace the car to its owner, 38-year-old Patricia Meehan. They immediately begin to search for her. A few hours later, police call off their search for the night. Over the next 5 days, they search on land and from the air, but they find no trace of Patricia Meehan. There were two theories as to how Patricia left the area. She may have stowed away on a hay truck that was seen about a half a mile from the accident scene, or she simply hitched a ride. At least 100 people have reported seeing Patricia Meehan since she vanished. Patricia has made no attempt whatsoever to contact her family or friends. Authorities believe that she may be suffering from amnesia. Just before the accident, those who knew her well noticed that Patricia seemed depressed and withdrawn.
She was, I guess, taking all her own life. What had she accomplished? I think she missed having children, because I think now she found out she really does love them.
After she disappeared, her family found a roll of undeveloped film still in her camera. It contained this haunting self-portrait.
It appears that Pat was experiencing a very difficult time in her life and was involved in a rather dramatic accident, which may have involved a head injury. The combination of these factors may have caused amnesia. She does not know who she is, has lost memories of the past, and is out searching for herself throughout the country.
Patricia was spotted dozens of times between Montana and Seattle, mainly at truck stops. But in every case, she had hitchhiked out of the area by the time the authorities arrived.
I don't know how she's eating. I don't know where she's sleeping. From the sightings, quite a few of them, she was seen crying.
One of the confirmed sightings of Patricia occurred in Bozeman, Montana, just a few miles from her home.
Patty came in the door and wanted to be sat quickly and served quickly. She asked me if she would be able to be out of there in rather of a hurry, and I said, well, we do breakfast in 10 minutes, you'll be out very quickly. And then I made a comment to her that she must have to be back to work at 9 o'clock, since it was almost 9, it was about 8:30, 20 till. She said, no, I'm just going shopping. I couldn't understand what it was so important for her to be there right at 9 o'clock to go shopping, you know, when she was in such a huge hurry.
Another waitress also noticed that Patricia was acting strangely.
What stood out in my mind is that she seemed really disorientated, really spacey, and just looking off into space. And I heard her like talking to herself, but I really didn't hear what she was saying, because I had other people and other customers to take care of. She sat at that table for an hour and a half or more, easily. She was just, you know, looking out the window, looking at people walking by. That's when I walked up to her and I asked her, are you okay?
Are you sure?
And I was just wondering if there's anything I could do, you know, because she was just like lost. I felt like she didn't know where she was or who she was.
Although years have passed with no word from Patricia, her family still holds out hope that she may one day find her way home.
Well, more than anything else in the world, I want her back with us. And we would then know that she'd be safe, not knowing who she's going to get a ride from. And that's my biggest worry, I think. Just prays on your mind day in and day out. And you pray to God and hope that she's with some good people.
Patricia Meehan is 5'3" in height and is slight in build, with strawberry blonde hair, freckles, and a fair complexion. Her eyes are greenish-gray in color. Next, a young woman starts a new life in a new town, but meets a tragic end on a darkened street. Baton Rouge, Louisiana. 26-year-old Tracy Wofford Bunn was a recent transplant to this city.
Tracy was a beautiful person, outgoing, fun to be with. She would do things very spur of the moment. She could say, well, tomorrow I'm going to Minnesota. Tomorrow she'd go to Minnesota with no care whatsoever, wondering about what might happen. She knew where she was going.
Tracy had been living in Milwaukee. After 2.5 years of marriage, Tracy decided she needed a change. She went to visit her sister in Louisiana.
She had spoken many times about leaving to sort of spread her wings and try something new, and so she just came to visit me, and we had a really good time, and I introduced her to quite a few different type people, and so she stayed with me, I think, a couple of weeks, and then she went back home and stayed about a week and a half and came back down with all of the rest of her stuff.
Tracy settled in quickly. She landed a job as a waitress and started a new relationship. She couldn't have been happier. But 6 months later, life took a tragic turn. Outside of an apartment complex, someone walking by noticed a young woman who looked like she was asleep in the front seat of a car. It quickly became obvious that she was not asleep. Tracy had been murdered. The police determined that Tracy had been raped and strangled to death. Oddly, investigators found no signs of a struggle. In fact, there were a number of things about the crime scene that didn't quite fit.
Upon examining the body, we could see that the clothes were all jumbled up in a fashion that I have seen before, and it's usually when a person has had their clothing put back on them, and they're either in an unconscious state or they're deceased. We also found that the stick shift was broken off in the car. It's lying on the floorboard. I still believe the vehicle could have been driven, but it would have taken somebody with a little expertise at doing it to drive it with the stick shift broken off like that. The motive, the main thing that has me puzzled is because there was no robbery. The jury was still on the victim, purse was there, identification. This was just a total loss of life for no reason.
With no physical evidence to go on, Detective Wheeler questioned the people who knew Tracy best. He started with her boyfriend.
And we just rode around for a little while.
Well, when I spoke with the boyfriend, he advised me that about 4:30, he dropped Tracy off at work, and he kept her vehicle. He and his cousin were riding around in the car, and he was supposed to pick Tracy up at night at 12 midnight when she got off work. Unfortunately, he said a shift lever broke off in the vehicle at Texas and East Polk. They parked the vehicle and went to the cousin's house, which is about a half a mile away.
Man, let's go ahead and leave it here. We'll come back and get it tomorrow.
Around midnight, Tracy called her boyfriend and heard the bad news about her car. She left work and walked to his cousin's house, about a mile away.
What happened to the car?
It broke. It's broken.
Give me the keys.
Tracy then walked the half mile to her car. Police estimate that she arrived at around 12:30 a.m.
We know she got to the vehicle because it was locked up by her boyfriend when he left it there. And when we found the vehicle that next morning, the keys were in the vehicle. But that is the last place that we could positively say she was alive at when she arrived at the car.
An hour later, Tracy's car was driven to the apartment complex where she was found dead the next morning.
I was advised by the apartment manager that there was possibly a witness who saw the vehicle when it came into the parking lot around 1:30 a.m. and saw somebody walk away from it, didn't pay any much attention to it.
Not only had Tracy been raped and strangled, but there were mysterious second-degree burns on her thighs and on the back of her hands.
We haven't been able to determine what caused those burns. And we've thought about every type of heating apparatus or device you could think of. We just can't find anything that would make that particular burn. We also don't understand the method of leaving the body the way it was. It was like they wanted this person to be found and they wanted everybody to see. I don't know whether these guys were involved in drugs or not, but when you have a case involving people in narcotics, if you don't deal with them in the fashion that they want you to, they'll make an example out of you.
I know someone personally that was very heavily involved in drugs. And he was, I guess he was trying to make some sort of drug transaction. And he was told that that person was the person who had murdered my sister.
Authorities investigated a local drug dealer, but found no evidence linking him to the murder. Suspicion then shifted back to Tracy's boyfriend.
It's my feeling that her boyfriend knew something because he had her car that night while she was at work. He didn't come and pick her up from work at the agreed upon time. Apparently when she went by his cousin's house to pick up the car, he told her that it was broken and that, you go on ahead. And it doesn't sound like a likely story for a person who was supposed to be involved with my sister to just sort of throw her to the wolves at 12 or 1 o'clock at night.
Tracy's boyfriend and his cousin were each given 2 polygraph examinations. They both passed and were ruled out as suspects.
It's even now, it's hard to believe, even though I've seen her body, I've seen her, I've buried her, because I really don't know what happened. And I think if I knew what happened, I'd be able to believe that it's happened and sort of leave it behind me.
Update. 18 years after Tracy was murdered, police checked DNA from the crime scene against records in the National DNA database. They came up with a match to a convicted rapist named Fred McGinley. However, McGinley had died in prison several years before, and the case was officially closed. Next, former residents claim that this house is haunted, and they have a picture to prove it. Fish Springs, Nevada. In this small town stands a farmhouse that dates back more than a century. It was originally built next to a graveyard in Virginia City, Nevada, and has been moved 3 times. Former residents believe that something supernatural moved along with it.
I've always loved older homes, and I'm fascinated by them, by their building, and the fact that they have so much history that they've withstood all that time. I just feel like they have a memory of their own. Just like people, they can remember the past and things that have happened there.
2 different families say they've had supernatural encounters in the house. One even has a photograph of the ghost. His name is Samuel. The Kelsey family bought the house exactly 100 years to the day after the man who built it died. From the start, there was something unsettling about the house.
I felt like we had gotten more than we bargained for. and I wouldn't walk through the house in the dark at all for fear that I was gonna run into something, something that wasn't supposed to be there. Just as you're getting to sleep, you would hear footsteps walking up and down the stairs.
What's wrong?
We got really scared, or I did anyway.
The Kelsey's daughter, Jennifer, who was then only 4 years old, had an even more bizarre experience.
I just woken up for some reason, I don't know why, and I saw this little boy. He looked like he was sad, and the man, he just looked like he was really concerned. And it was just only there for a few seconds, but then it just like disappeared. It was weird. They didn't look familiar to me at all, but the way they were looking at me, it just seemed like they knew me.
But seeing ghosts was just the beginning.
The levitation was the same night that I saw him. But I just remember laying there in my bed. It seemed like my whole bed was just like floating.
After Jennifer told me what had happened, I was very scared that things were starting to happen that aren't supposed to happen normally, and I told my husband about it.
Jim and Susan Kelsey decided to call in a local man named Daniel Martin, who had a reputation as a psychic.
When I first talked to Mrs. Kelsey, she was more concerned, confused, because she didn't understand what was happening.
After visiting the house, Martin returned to his home and put himself in a deep trance. And that's when he met Kelsey's ghost.
I contacted an entity and I asked him, "Who are you?" And he told me his name was Samuel. And he told me at the time that his purpose there was to protect the child. And he was there not to harm anybody. And I explained to him that he was frightening the family. And Samuel promised not to do these things in the future.
The Kelseys became convinced that their ghost, Samuel, was harmless. 3 years later, they moved to a more modern house nearby and leased the old house to a potential buyer. By then, the Kelseys had 3 children, including an infant son. When the baby was just 7 weeks old, Susan took a series of photographs of him at the new house.
When I went to pick the pictures up, I opened them up and I pulled them out, and there was a man on the first picture. And I thought, these aren't my pictures. So I went through them, and after that initial picture, everything in there, the roll was of my son. And I checked my negative and the man was on it. The only way I can explain the photograph is that it is of our ghost Samuel, because my daughter had told me about 3 weeks earlier that she felt that he had moved with us.
The mysterious photograph became front page news in Fish Springs, but nobody in town recognized the man in the picture. We brought in a photographic expert to analyze the picture.
The image is three-dimensional and has reflected qualities. Where the skin is tight against the skull, it's brighter and there's highlights there. A manifestation of a ghost is usually thought of as transparent or self-illuminant, and this is definitely reflected light. I detected lines, horizontal lines, across the image. In conclusion, I would say that Samuel's ghost was made off of a large television screen.
The picture of Samuel is not a fake. There's a lot of things that can't be explained, and I just think this is one of them.
The Kelseys insist that they have never photographed their television screen. The true source of the image is still a mystery. Meanwhile, for 15 months, the new tenants at the Fish Springs house reported nothing out of the ordinary. But then the house was rented to another family. Steve and Mona Robinson hadn't heard about the house's ghostly reputation. They had to learn that for themselves.
I felt that there was ghosts in the house, but then I kept telling myself no. And things started happening more and more. The footsteps, the bangs. I'd bring it up to Steve once in a while, And he would say, no, there's got to be some reason. You know, it's an old house. We even thought about pipes. You know, we thought of all kinds of things.
Then their 11-year-old son, Garrett, had a frightening experience.
I started hearing noises upstairs, like, and there was walking, bangings and stuff. I went up to the top of the stairs. I started hearing humming, three different voices. I then ran out the door. When I got out, when I was inside my driveway, there was all this banging of the screen door. And then, for some reason, I looked over to the window, and I saw this old guy, and then he had this drain on his face.
Also, 6-year-old Miles reported a strange occurrence.
I remember one night I was getting lifted out of bed. I got lifted up pretty high. I didn't know what was happening. I just got lifted up.
Then one night, Mona Robinson finally reached the end of her rope.
I couldn't sleep, and I could hear bangs in the hallway, like coming down the stairs. Then all of a sudden, I heard right behind my bed in a man's voice, call me bitch. It was a mad voice. Mad. Angry.
I thought, you know, that she was going nuts, but at the same time, I believed her. She refused to go to bed. She was always afraid that once we got into bed, the noises would start. So she'd stay up all night long.
I felt like they were trying to drive me crazy. You never believe anything like that until it happens to you.
But the Kelseys, who still own the house, did believe them. Once again, they called for Daniel Martin.
At that time, I encountered three entities, two men and one woman. My first impressions when I approached these entities were that they were of the Virginia City era back in the old days. These entities were not destructive. They were just cantankerous, kind of a rowdy little gang of troublemakers. It had been and still was.
Martin says that he asked the spirits to leave the house, but it was too late to do the Robinsons any good. The Robinsons moved out of the house less than 4 months after they moved in. For Steve Robinson, it wasn't a minute too soon.
I'd like to see it destroyed. I think it is a center point for spirits. The house is something keeping it alive. I'd like to see it burned to the ground.
But the old house still stands in Fish Springs, Nevada. And maybe you'll move in next. Coming up, FBI surveillance of a quiet New Jersey suburb uncovers a vast international drug ring. On a previous broadcast, we profiled Brenda Abbey, who was on a quest to unravel a personal, unsolved mystery. Brenda was adopted as an infant. She didn't know much about her birth parents, Elizabeth Hansen and Walter Perry. But she did know that they were employed by the Settlin and Wilson Carnival during the 1940s.
Every time I hear over the news that there's a carnival, I will go. And I go up to every booth, every concession. I go up to every person that's employed by that carnival, and I look at them just to see if I can find somebody that looks like me.
How long have you been with the carnival?
With the carnival, 18
During a search that spanned 30 years, Brenda talked with dozens of old-timers.
Are they with the carnival?
Nope.
No.
But no one claimed to know either Elizabeth Hansen or Walter Perry. It seemed Brenda might finally be out of options. Update. The response to Brenda's story was better than she had hoped. Not only did her birth mother call our phone center, but so did two sisters and a brother. A reunion was held in St. Clair Shores, Michigan. Brenda's birth mother was unable to attend, but Brenda finally met four of her long-lost siblings. Although Brenda learned that her birth father had died in 1959, she was thrilled to find out that she had a total of 11 brothers and sisters. Not all have been located yet.
I did my own search and kept running into dead ends and finally gave up. When I found out about this, it was incredible.
It's amazing. It's unbelievable. Totally unbelievable. It's funny to actually walk up to people and touch their skin and know that they're related.
And feel sad.
These are my flesh and blood, and it's something nobody can take away from me.
That's right.
And it's such a great feeling.
It's worth the search.
It was worth the 30 years that it took me to do this.
When we heard Brenda's story a second time, she located another brother living in Florida, as well as a pair of twin siblings from Ohio. All of her 11 brothers and sisters are now accounted for. Cliffside Park, New Jersey. This quiet, wealthy neighborhood seems to be an unlikely place to find a criminal gang. But its isolation and security was exactly what the mastermind of a drug and money laundering ring was looking for.
What's the name of aquí? Nada.
Pedro Uribe was a 38-year-old Colombian with direct ties to the infamous Medellin cartel, and he ran his criminal organization with a ruthless hand.
Yo soy el jefe aquí.
Pedro Uribe ran this organization by fear. Informant information tells us that one of his couriers lost 75 kilos of cocaine. Uribe, on hearing this, had this individual as well as his family members murdered.
It later turned out that the man was innocent. This only added to Pedro's fearsome reputation.
Surveillance site 4 is ready.
Roger, standing by.
To try to catch Pedro, the FBI set up around-the-clock surveillance of his known properties. They soon learned that in order to appear normal, people pretending to be family members were trucked in on weekends. The surveillance showed that these fake families changed from week to week.
One of the primary features that they looked for when renting these houses was an attached garage with an automatic garage door opener, and if it didn't have it, they'd install one. This was done so they could get in and out with different individuals and less chance of being seen by the neighbors.
Using these houses as a base, Pedro developed a simple but effective money laundering scheme. Low-level operatives, nicknamed Smurfs by the FBI, were dispatched from the houses to banks throughout the New York metropolitan area.
Yes, could I please have a money order for $1,980?
These Smurfs used small amounts of Pedro's drug money to buy legitimate money orders from many different banks.
At the height of the operation, there were seven Smurfs identified that were money laundering $50,000 a day, and during five working days, they could money launder up to $2 million a week.
The FBI knew that Pedro was laundering millions, but they had yet to prove that he dealt cocaine. And then one day, they got lucky. Outside of one of Pedro's safe houses, agents observed the delivery of some mysterious boxes. Gambling that they contained cocaine, the FBI tried to catch Pedro red-handed. Following night, they made their move.
FBI, open up!
Listen, I got a female suspect in the living room. Come up here, I need a search.
Bam, we got 20.
In their search of the house, the FBI found 307 kilos of 95% pure cocaine wrapped in plastic bags. The total amount of the cocaine seized that night was worth $7 million on the street. FBI agents searched Pedro's other safe houses, and in one, a specially trained dog led the FBI directly to a large potted plant.
Good dog, what's that? You got a hit. Good dog, oh boy.
When the plant was examined, agents found $800,000 in cash covered with enough traces of cocaine to have attracted the dog's attention. However, Pedro and his henchmen had been tipped off and managed to escape. Today, he and his associates are wanted fugitives. Pedro Uribe could be commuting between Colombia and the United States. He is known to have relatives in New Jersey. Two of Pedro's partners in crime are also Colombian nationals. They have been identified as Luis and Ivan Arango. Another Uribe henchman, Miguel Villegas, is believed to be in the Los Angeles area.